Like every day, Felix is sitting by the river. It is a nice day. The sun is warming his skin and a light breeze is playing with his hair. Felix is a fisher who has been coming to this spot for decades. The fish he catches here every day feed his children, and what's left over he can sell in the village. At least he used to. 5 years ago, a steel production plant opened a few kilometers upstream, which leaks chemicals into the river. Slowly, the water quality has worsened and the fish have nearly died out. The ones Felix is able to catch now are small and sickly. They are barely enough to feed his children. He knows this cannot continue. But how could things change? This negative side effect of steel production, which is not accounted for in any way on the balance sheet of the steel company, is a typical case of an externality. Steel production is, of course, of great use to society and should not be stopped. But if negative externalities are not accounted for, great damage can be done, and those responsible have no incentive to change things. In the past, creating those incentives was a lot easier, through imposing social sanctions. If you decided to have a dump in the river that everybody gets their drinking water from, because you like the convenience of having water to wash yourself with afterwards, a negative externality will arise in the form of people that get their water downstream becoming sick. Since you are a part of that community, however, you will quickly be sanctioned by your peers. At first with disapproving looks, then words, and slowly escalating to loss of reputation and eventually expulsion. But in today's world, CEOs of large companies aren't living next to the rivers they pollute. They don't face these immediate personal consequences. So what incentive do they have to act against their objective, maximizing profit? One very slow way is creating social sanctions on a much larger scale, through consumer choice. If people only buy products that don't pollute rivers, profit for polluting companies will disappear. Sadly, we are usually not that coordinated as a society. So, the quicker way is entrusting that sanctioning to a representative body, aka governments. Governments can impose taxes or regulate how much companies are allowed to pollute, preferably zero, or at least below levels considered safe. If a tax on pollution based on the marginal cost this pollution causes to society is able to make this negative externality show up in the company's balance sheet, it has been internalized, and the company CEO has an incentive to decrease the amount of chemicals put in the river. Fisher Felix can go back to fishing and feed his family at the village. Not all externalities are bad, of course. There are positive externalities too. For example, using automated toll booths on highways not only makes traffic smoother, but research has shown that it can even improve infant health in nearby areas by reducing air pollution. In the early 2000s, when the EasyPass system was introduced in Pennsylvania and New Jersey, infants born with a low birth weight within a 2 kilometer radius around the toll booth decreased by 10% in comparison to infants born 2 to 10 kilometers away from the toll booth. Therefore, introducing this system and the reduction in stationary traffic it caused had a positive externality on public health in the surrounding area. Due to exponential technology, however, humanity's impact on ecological systems at this point goes far beyond county or national level. Nowadays, we face externalities across borders, most easily illustrated by changes to the world climate system. Take the Amazon rainforest, for example. According to international law, Brazil owns a very large part of it. From an economic perspective, it would be a great idea for them to continue the slash and burn policies promoted under Bolsonaro to expand their agricultural production, grow their GDP, and become a more important international player. Annoyingly, this strategy not only has the massive negative externality of diminishing the world's genetic biodiversity reserves, but also heavily messes with the global climate system by disrupting water circulation patterns in the Atlantic and trace gas concentrations in the atmosphere. But when only considering Brazil's relative international advantage, chopping down the Amazon rainforest still seems viable, maybe even smart. The agricultural production creates an absolute increase in Brazil's economic competitiveness, while the negative externality more or less impacts every country in the world in the same negative way. So what is there to incentivize Brazil from following this course of action? Currently, we don't have a very good answer, but I would like to explore the various approaches to this issue in the next few videos. So if you like this one, please give it a thumbs up. It serves as great feedback to me on what areas to explore next. I wish you a fantastic day. Let's regenerate the Earth.